What do you see in the Gardner syndrome? Multiple osteomas are the classical feature. Maxillary osteomas is what you see in the case of the Gardner syndrome, which is the most common retroorbital mass that you see in the adults. Another favorite question of the examiner. Quickly tell me, doctor, what are all the orbital masses that you see as an ophthalmologist or an oncologist in pediatric and the adults? Dermoid cyst, capillary hemangioma, and the rhabdomyosarcoma is what you see in pediatric age group. Whereas lymphoid tumor, meningioma, and cavernous hemangioma is what you see in the case of the adults. One thing you need to be careful, cavernous hemangioma is seen in adults and capillary hemangioma is seen in the pediatric age group is what I want to underscore to all of you. Now this gives you a typical MRI appearance. You can see this is the globe. You can see there is a mass here that is there in the orbit, which is basically here. You compare the two eyes, you can see there is no mass here, there is a mass here. Okay. So this is the orbital mass, basically the appearance of a cavernous hemangioma of the orbit with dilated vascular channels can be identified in a T2 weighted image like this is what I want to underscore. So it is the most common benign solitary lesion in the adults, cavernous hemangioma. And in the case of the women, typically pregnancy will make it to become rapidly grown. It causes intraocular pressure, increased ocular pressure. Strabismus and hyperopia can be one of the presenting features. Let's go to the next question. On echocardiography, what is the typical movement if there is any mitral valve calcification? This is a little higher plane question. Postgraduate entrance expected to test MBBS knowledge. But our MBBS students are known to know about echo findings also. Probably a DM question bank question has jumped into this. But anyway, these are all fundamental things here. Because mitral stenosis, everything that is what you commonly come across, a stenotic valve, rheumatic heart disease is so prevalent in this nation, you need to know minimum things. In mitral stenosis, there is a decreased diastolic excursion of the mitral leaflets. Generally, if you take the anterior and posterior leaflet, they don't move peripassive. But in the case, if there is any calcification of the mitral valve, then there will be anterior and posterior leaflets will be moving concordantly and anteriorly. So side by side movement is what will be occurring if there is any valve calcification is what I want to underscore to all of you. So this is an example of a severely dilated left atrium. This much a big left atrium is not seen. And you can also see the presence of the thickened valve, mitral valve is what I want to underscore. So let's go to the next question. What is the most common cause for the peripheral limb ischemia? So what is the answer you want to know? It is the typical side to side movement can be considered as a possible potential answer. Let's go to the next question. Most common peripheral limb ischemia, how many answered in the yesterday's exam? Atherosclerosis as the answer. That's one common possible prediction. But in India, Burgers, thrombangitis obliterans is very common, which is found in the case of the smokers is what need to be remembered. Now can you tell me, doctor, what is this typical angiogram is showing you? Asian women who are very young have come with accelerated hypertension and you have clinically examined and one more clue if I give you an answer. Yes? Excellent. Aortoarthritis, Takayasu arthritis, where there will be pulselessness because of the stenosis is what need to be remembered. So you can see right subclavian and the left common carotid, they both got stenosed in the Takayasu arthritis, very common in the Asian women. What is most common location for the intracranial neurocysticercosis, doctor? It can occur within the ventricles also, but more common will be in the brain parenchyma. You see, there is one caudate nucleus. Here also is one caudate nucleus. This is basically internal capsule. And this is the head of the caudate. So you can see there is a cyst. Scolex can be clearly appreciated at the level of this caudate. Compare the two caudate is what you see with the multiple calcifications in the case of the neurocysticercosis. Neurocysticercosis, toxoplasmosis, tuberculosis of the brain. Those three are the closest differential diagnosis and lymphoma. How do you differentiate them? Radiologically is a favorite question. In which case midline shift will be there, where perilesional edema will be there, where massive perilesional edema will be there. Anyway, in the future tests, we will try to revise that. Which is a chemotherapeutic agent which is given by continuous infusion, doctor? It is typically the arabinoside, the fludarabine, cytosine arabinoside. In those leukemias of the children which got relapsed, typically they are used as a part of the chemotherapy in continuous infusion is what need to be given. Methotrexate is given to prevent relapse in what route, doctor? Intrathecally. Into the CSF, it will be given is what need to be remembered. Which carcinoma is most frequently metastasizing the brain, doctor? Small cell carcinoma is what the golden rule that you should not basically forget. So small cell, squamous cell are central. Adenocarcinoma is peripheral. is the golden rule that should not be forgotten. So you can see the presence of a tumor, the small cell carcinoma, how it is, and that led to phrenic nerve palsy. Hence the diaphragm got elevated is what I want to underscore. So this is a classical appearance. Also you can see typically in the perihilar lesion location centrally, the small cell carcinoma will be located, and sometimes even the pulmonary artery can become encased within the small cell carcinoma. That's how it happens. Small cell carcinoma can metastasize so diffusely by the time you diagnose itself. That's how if you do the scintigraphy, you can find the presence of the multiple metastasis in the bone is what I want to underscore. Now I like to give you a short quiz. Based on these appearances, is it central, is it peripheral, and how these cells are looking like, among which variant of carcinoma do you want to consider it? Think and tell. Yes. One positive bet, three people can take three different options. Come on, fast. So please remember, it is an adenocarcinoma of the lung which is more peripherally located, and it is a typical adenomatous glandular structure is what you are seeing histologically. Now can you tell me this important carcinoma, what type it would have been? You can see the presence of the cavitation which is there in this, and the wonderful, it is a cavitary squamous cell carcinoma is something that should not be forgotten. And these are the typical brain metastasis which can occur in the case of the small cell carcinoma. Let's go to the next question. Intensity modulated radiotherapy, once more, third quartile question this is. In which type of cancer do you basically do this, doctor? What is the meaning of it? Basically, it's one of the advanced mode of the high precision radiotherapy, where there is a computer controlled X-ray accelerators will be there. They'll be delivering a precise amount of the radiation. So what will computer will be doing? It'll be modulating and controlling the intensity of the radiation beam, and it will be basically deciding which area is more tumorous in nature. To that particular area, it will be delivering it. So basically the purpose of using this technique called intensity modulated radiotherapy is avoid injury to the other normal tissues and only try to focus upon what you call the malignant tissue. So typically in the case of the prostate carcinoma, the computer will be identifying basically which is the area which need to be targeted and which is the area which is involved with the malignancy, and into that it is being done. Even in the case of the brain tumor, radio surgery management also we use basically a computerized analysis is what need to be remembered. And also a large scale intensity modulated radiation therapies are used in those sensitive structures where their surrounding tissues are much more sensitive. So that's the reason thyroid malignancy, prostate, head and neck malignancy, breast and lung cancer, in all these areas typically this IMRT is the technique which is used is what I want to underscore. Let's go to the next question. In papillary carcinoma of the thyroid, the radioiodine destroys the neoplastic cells because of which rays is the question. Once more, another tricky question many times came in entrance. What is the difference between I-123 and I-131? Which is diagnostic, which is basically used for therapeutic is a very important question. Can we use both of them? So I-125 decays basically by electron capture. It has got a half-life of 60 days. Basically, the orbital electron is captured by the nucleus and a neutrino will be forming, and neutrino is emitted out of the nucleus, and it is the one which will be causing the release of the energy by disintegration is what need to be remembered. Whereas I-131, unlike I-125 which has 60 days of half-life, it has got a half-life of about 8 days. It emits the beta particles which have got a maximum energy. It also emits gamma rays also, but more important is those beta rays which are the ones which have anti-neoplastic nature is what need to be basically remembered. Sometimes if 10 to 20 millibecquerels of I-131 would have been administered for a diagnostic purpose, it will even deplete the thyroid itself. So it also have got a neoplastic depletive effects also is what need to be remembered. So now I will give you a small challenge. A 34-year-old woman has presented with a palpable right-sided neck mass. It is of about 5 months duration, and on physical examination it is felt to be very firm. Thyroid functions are absolutely normal, and a radioactive iodine uptake was done and it is decreased to 22%. And also there is a histology of that particular thyroid which is firm in a young lady, 34 years old, palpable. Now can you tell me what is the diagnosis? Possibly, yes. It is a 34-year-old female. Can we think of a malignancy in this situation? And radioactive iodine uptake typically is decreased. It is a very classical feature. It is seen in the case of the Hashimoto's thyroiditis. In the late stage, the radioactive iodine uptake becomes diminished is what need to be basically remembered. Now let's go to the next question. which is the chemotherapeutic agent which has a selective action on those tumor cells which are only hypoxic, not on other ones. Typically it is the mitomycin is what need to be basically remembered. It is used for several different types of cancer, including the breast cancer, stomach cancer, esophagus cancer, bladder cancer is the place where it will be used, mitomycin, specific for the hypoxic cells. The paraneoplastic syndrome, lot of questions from oncology, right? So paraneoplastic syndrome associated with the Hodgkin's disease typically is, by chance is the exam director is HOD of oncology this time? No. So, but anyway, oncology is rapidly growing department, doctor. Typically in Hodgkin's, cerebellar degenerative disease will be there. A patient with Hodgkin's presenting with ataxia, imbalance, dysgeidocochinesia, you need to contemplate for the possibility of the cerebellar degenerative disease is what I want to underscore. One of the favorite questions of the examiner, which is the typical antibody which will be mediating the paraneoplastic cerebellar degeneration? Anti-YO antibody is what need to be basically remembered. So you can see, doctor, cerebellum has got certain folia. If you take an MRI, generally you don't expect cerebellum folia to be so prominent. Unless it got degenerated, the folia becomes so prominent. So this is the MRI that can pick up the cerebellar degenerative disease, which can occur as a part of the paraneoplastic syndrome, just like the Lambert-Eaton syndrome, which is reverse myasthenia is what need to be remembered. Let's go to the next question. Which radioactive isotope is not used for the brachytherapy? It is used more for the external therapy. Iodine-125 is used for the cancer brachytherapy in the case of the prostate in the brain. And it is diagnostically also used to evaluate the filtration of the kidney, and in the radio immunoassays also it is widely used. I-131 is basically used in treating the thyroid cancer and in the imaging of the thyroid. But it is not really used for brachytherapy more than the I-125. Whereas the cobalt-60, undoubtedly it is used for the external beam radiotherapy, and also cobalt is placed in the brachytherapy. Iridium is supplied in a wire form. It is typically used in the brachytherapy once more as an internal radiotherapy source. So that is the reason iridium, cobalt, iodine-125 can be used, but not iodine-131 is going to be your answer. Let's go to the next question. Sarcoma spread hematogenously, carcinoma spread lymphatically. What is the exception? Synovial sarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, epithelioid sarcoma, they spread lymphatically atypically. But neurofibrosarcoma will be spreading hematogenously is what need to be remembered. Which oncogene is associated with the medullary carcinoma of the thyroid is another important question. So all of you know it is the red proto-oncogene is what I want to underscore. What do you mean by red, doctor? Rearranged during transfection gene is the name which gave it the red. And it is first cloned in 1985. The mutations of this red gene are identified in multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2A and type 2B and in medullary thyroid carcinoma. And even in the Hirschsprung's disease also red mutations are identified. Probably this can become a potential MCQ. What are all the conditions where it is seen? And also in papillary thyroid carcinomas also red oncogene is known to show certain mutations. Where do you find HER2 new oncogene, doctor? It is the one which is found in the case of the breast cancer. If you want to determine the prognosis, and it also helps you to guide the treatment, HER2 new antigen is the one tumor marker in breast cancer is what I want to underscore. Let's go to the next question. 30-year-old came with arterial attenuation, cotton wool spots, flame-shaped hemorrhages. You can never do a mistake after finishing housemanship. Fun does need to be seen, doctor. If you have not seen, at least today you see. That's very, very important rule. Until you get cervical spondylosis, you must keep seeing the fundus. That should be the rule. Whether pregnant female is your patient, whether it is HIV, where you are thinking CMV retinitis, whether it is an elderly individual with hypertension, you need to make it a habit, doctor. So basically, how do you grade the fundus in the hypertension is very important rule. Grade 1 means there is an arteriolar attenuation. Generally, when you peep through the fundus, you expect arterioles to be visible. They are not visible. So that is grade 1. In addition to that, there is a arteriovenous nipping and AV crossing is occurring. Then that is grade 2. Grade 3 means cotton wool spots, retinal exudates, edema, all these things will appear. Grade 4 means in addition to grade 3, you also find optic disc swelling. Then it is called as a grade 4, otherwise called a malignant phase is what need to be remembered. Now, generally for the grade 2 and 3, some of the standard textbooks use copper and silver wire, but I have never appreciated. To be honest, Because whenever we peep through the fundus, we see whether papilledema is there. Thank you, grade 4 it is not. No need for running a nitroglycerin infusion. Then we see for the grade 3, then flame-shaped hemorrhages are there, that is sufficient. Then if AV nipping is there, then it is grade 2. Grade 1 is generally worried about the HOD will catch you, you will be putting as grade 1. Grade 1 is a general thing, like a non-specific dyspepsia. So let's go to the thing. This is an example of a flame-shaped hemorrhage. This is a hard exudate. This is a cotton wool soft exudate, and you can see the presence of the papilledema. Very classical in the case of the hypertensive retinopathy. So hemorrhages, hard exudates, and a blurring of the optic disc should not be forgotten. Now a small challenge for you. What is this fundus? Which grade do you like to consider? Are you finding any exudates? No. Are you finding any papilledema shown here? No. At least are you finding any AV nipping? No. But how is the arteriole? It got attenuated. So that is the reason it is an example of a grade A hypertensive retinopathy. In this case, what do you like to consider it as? What you can see is there is some amount of arteriovenous nipping is there. So this is a classical AV nipping. And what is this grade? What are you finding here in this fundus? Some amount of hemorrhage is definitely visible over here. So that is the reason it's a grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy with disc edema can be appreciated and the hard exudate at the macula. And what is this, doctor? This is a grade 3 hypertensive retinopathy. Still the fundus is not showing the blurring. That's the reason it is grade 3. And what is this type of grade of hypertensive retinopathy, doctor? It is a grade B. What you are not finding any kind of papilledema in this given case. Really fundus is not really that, the optic disc is not really that swollen. And it's an example of a diabetic proliferative retinopathy where you can find the appearance of the neovascularization. So two ways eye can become affected. Macular edema is one way, other is proliferative retinopathy, which you have to identify in every diabetic with at least 2 to 3 years history in type 2 and more than 5 years history in type 1 is with a golden rule. Let's go to the next question. 55-year-old female came with the eye pain, redness, diminution of the vision and shallow anterior chamber. Do you want to immediately go for laser iridectomy? Iridotomy otherwise. Okay, is it closed angle or open angle glaucoma he's talking about? Closed angle glaucoma. Narrow angle glaucoma otherwise. Okay. So the strategy is to lower the intraocular pressure as the first priority. After it is being lowered, then you try to treat the patient with closed angle glaucoma with the surgery. And prophylactically in the other eye also you do the iridectomy is the rule. Now what are the different strategies? Block the aqueous production, reduce the vitreous volume, facilitate the aqueous outflow is the golden rule. To block the aqueous production, you can use a beta antagonist like timolol or a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor like estazolamide or apraclonidine can be used. To reduce the vitreous volume, you can use the glycerol or isosorbide or mannitol or any other hyperosmotic agent. Accordingly, mannitol comes into the role. To facilitate the aqueous outflow, you can use a meiotic like the pilocarpine is the golden rule. But the question is, it is only the third step but not the first step is the thing that is frequently asked in the entrance exam. So please remember, pilocarpine is not the first step because the intraocular pressure need to be first of all brought down to about 40 millimeters of mercury and then only the pharmacological meiosis is induced by administering the pilocarpine is the golden rule. So once the acute attack is brought down, then peripheral iridotomy is having any role. So that's the reason. What is your final answer, doctor? Your answer is IV mannitol is going to be the rule. Atropine is dangerous in that situation. It leads to pupillary dilatation, further worsen the situation. Let's go to the next question. 55-year-old with decreased distance vision. Now he does not require glasses. What is the reason? It's called second sight, which you see in the case of the senile nuclear sclerosis, which is the most common type of the cataract. Usually it takes decades to develop and early in the course he requires the glasses, late in the course he does not require. Now why he does not require the reading glasses, not the distant vision glasses, reading glasses? So why he does not require it? Because the progression of the cataract will increase the dioptric power of the lens by inducing certain amount of mild to moderate degree of myopia. Because of that myopia which is developing within his lens, he does not require any more of that reading glasses, which is called second sight. But this privilege is there only for a short period of time, doctor. further the lens deteriorates and the second sight is eventually lost is what need to be remembered. So typically this myopic shift and the second shift is not seen in the case of the cortical cataract or the posterior subcapsular cataract, but it is very classical of the nuclear sclerosis type of the senile cataract is the golden rule that should not be basically forgotten. So this is how the nuclear sclerosis which starts in our mid 40s will be progressing by the time we are mid 60s is what need to be remembered. Let's go to the next question. Which drug sulfa allergy, if it is there, esterzolamide contains a sulfa group. Now this is a challenging question. Homonymous hemianopia with a saccadic pursuit movement with a defective optokinetic nystagmus, which lobe is the lesion? One course question is going to come, doctor, at least in those days where Davidson used to be a great book, even today. So that particular illustration of the different types of lobes of the brain and their functions used to be a favorite. Don't forget, one question is going to come. Parietal lobe lesions. What is the functions of the dominant parietal and the non-dominant parietal lobe is one of the favorite question, doctor. If you don't remember, you will be entering into a grave in the exam. So graves is an easy way to remember. G for Gerstmann syndrome, R for receptive dysphagia, A for apraxia, V for a visual field effect, that is a contralateral homonymous hemianopia. E means exclusion of the other side. That is, they will have a hemisensory loss. Typically, the patient with a dominant parietal lobe will come with only half the shirt worn and come to you. Typically, his wife says, I don't know, half only he wants. You can ask, even hugging also only half is done or fully is it done. So that is the reason, doctor, hemisensory loss will be there is what need to be remembered. And agraphasthesia, 2-point discrimination loss and loss of stereognosis because the sensory impairment are classical of parietal. See, what brings the discriminatory senses? What are discriminatory senses, doctor? Position, vibration and touch are called discriminatory. Pain and temperature are not the discriminatory senses. They are all carried by the dorsal columns. Dorsal columns will not decussate until they reach the pyramid. After reaching the pyramid in the lower medulla, they decussate onto the contralateral side and ascend in medial lemniscus to reach the VPL nucleus in the thalamus. And from there, they will be reaching the somatosensory cortex in the parietal lobe. So, if parietal lobe is not functioning, even if the dorsal column brings all the sensations, you can't be able to discriminate is what need to be remembered. Now, can you tell me, which are those important tests that you will be doing to know whether parietal lobe got damaged, doctor? Give one 50 paisa coin to him, make him close eyes and place him in his hand. If he can't make it out, or in his palm you try to write, I love you, he can't recognize it. Then it is an example of graphesthesia, which is all very classical of the dominant parietal lobe, should not be forgotten. There is something called non-dominant lobe. Wax is what we used to remember. So visuospatial abnormalities, A for apraxia, constructional apraxia. Ask him to draw a star which you have drawn. He can't do that, constructional apraxia. Similarly, contralateral hemisensory loss will be there and a sensory inattention will be there. That is, make him close the eyes and two hands you touch, then one hand he can't perceive, other hand he can perceive. It is what is classically seen in the non-dominant hemisphere. So Gerstmann syndrome is a classical feature which is found in the case of the dominant hemispheric involvement, doctor. What is Gerstmann syndrome? Left right disorientation, he can't tell left from right. So finger agnosia, he can't point to the named fingers. And dyscalculia, dyslexia. So this combination is called Gerstmann syndrome, which is seen in the case of dominant parietal lobe involvement is what I want to underscore to all of you. Then the question has asked you, what is, there's also a problem in optokinetic nystagmus. In the clinical question, he has got a defective optokinetic nystagmus. What is meant by optokinetic nystagmus? Typically a drum will be rolling, doctor. Ask the patient to watch at that rolling drum which has got white and black stripes. Then continuously if he is watching at that rolling drum, then there will be a nystagmus that become elicited, which is the normal response of all of us. But in this individual who has got the parietal lobe involvement, then there will be an abnormal pursuit movement showing small saccadic movement which is seen in the case of the parietal lobe. That is, in a normal individual, quickly the saccade should occur as the drum is moving. But in him, there is a slow and delayed saccades which will be occurring, which is very classical of the parietal lobe. How many want to take up neurology, doctor? So, I hope a good number of you. Now, similarly, this is called as vertical nystagmus which is elicited. It is also a normal response. There is a fast saccade which is occurring as the drum is rolling. But if the saccade becomes slow, then it is called abnormal optokinetic nystagmus, which is seen in the case of typically the parietal lobe involvement is what I want to underscore. Now I'll give you a small challenge. A, B, C, D, E, F. If all these clinical features are given to you, which lobe do you want to say is the abnormality? Anosmia, apraxia, agraphia, behavioral changes, contralateral spastic paralysis and disinhibition of the bladder and also personality, expressive language defects, that is the Broca's aphasia is there, and fits of Jacksonian nature. Which lobe is it, doctor? Typically, it is the frontal lobe is something that should not be. Clean, bold, you should not be, doctor. So, then you need to remember, Dame V is a very important thing, doctor. So, dysphasia, auditory agnosia, memory impairment, emotional disturbance with aggression, rage, and hypersexuality, and also visual field defect, all these things are seen in the temporal lobe lesions is what need to be remembered. Whereas in the case of the occipital lobe, visual agnosia and contralateral homonymous hemianopia. So quickly, doctor, contralateral homonymous hemianopia is seen in occipital lobe and contralateral upper homonymous quadrantinopia is seen in the case of the temporal lobe and in the case of the frontal lobe, in the case of the temporal lobe and in the case of the frontal lobe, not much. But in the case of the parietal lobe, you should not forget it is also once more the contralateral homonymous hemianopia is what I want to underscore to all of you. Now let's go to the next question. Young, tall, thin male, arachnodactyly, ectopia lentis. If you are a veteran in writing entrances, it is Marfan syndrome. Where do you find sclerotitis, doctor? Which systemic disease? Rheumatoid arthritis should not be forgotten. Nodular sclerotitis with nodules with the thinning of the sclera, leading to the perforation of the sclera is what you see in the case of the scleromalacia perforans is what you can see in the case of the rheumatoid arthritis. Can you tell me involvement of the sclera, involvement of the exocrine glands in a patient with rheumatoid arthritis with the drying of the mouth? What is the disease? Sjögren syndrome, where the labial gland biopsy need to be done. If you do the biopsy, there will be lymphocytic infiltration is what I want to underscore. Let's go to the next question. Chlamydia, how do you identify? So culture, so many questions have come in this time entrance, you need to be very sure about. So, York sac inoculation, McCoy culture and BHK cells should not be forgotten. Not much of role for enzyme immunoassay, which you see in the case of ELISA in other conditions. So, chlamydia trachomatis, typically a McCoy cell culture will be of this nature. Let's go to the next question. When do you call blindness, doctor, when the visual acuity is less than about 3 by 60, it is called as the medically defined blindness. Normal pupillary response with the blindness. So this is a very important question, routine question. You need to remember it as a cortical blindness, whereas peripheral lesions, you have pupillary reflex defect and also the blindness. Whereas in the case of cortical blindness, pupillary reflex is not affected. You throw the light, it can very much constrict. Now, I like to quickly revise for you, how will be the pathway of the pupillary reflex? Very easy. Basically, you need to know that brainstem means medulla, pons, then midbrain, then above that you are having one thalamus and above that you are having one cerebral cortex. If you know that much, then you know everything about neurology, doctor. So let us talk about it. You have thrown the light into the retina. So the stimulus for the light reflex is basically the light. And the sensory arch will be passing from retina towards the tectal nucleus. Where is this pre-tectal nucleus located, doctor? It is located in the midbrain is what need to be remembered. You know, midbrain, next comes the pons and then comes the medulla. Now, what is the meaning of tectum? Tectum means roof. Tegmentum, tectum. Both the things will be there for the midbrain. Whereas the midbrain, both the things will be there for the midbrain. Whereas in the case of the pons, you have only the tegmentum. And below that medulla, neither tegmentum nor tectum will be there. So basically, tectum is something that you find in the case of the midbrain is what may be remembered. There some nuclei are being discovered. They are called pretectal nuclei. Now from pretectal nuclei, it will be going to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Now the question is, this side reflex will not only be going to the same side Edinger-Westphal, also to the contralateral Edinger-Westphal through the posterior commissure. That is the reason, directly if you throw light in this, even the other eye also will show the light response, which is called consensual light reflex. From the Edinger-Westphal, what will happen? Typically, it will be going towards the third cranial nerve's nucleus. From there, it will be going to ciliary ganglion. From there, it will be going to pupillar dilator pupillae, and constrictor pupillae muscles are over there. So, constrictor pupillae, it will be supplying. That's how the pupil will constrict, is what need to be remembered. So, there is a reason, doctor, the basic lesion occurs and the whole thing will be finished at the level of the midbrain itself. Cortical blindness is at the level of the occipital lobe and the cerebral cortex level. Hence, the midbrain is not yet affected. Hence, still these things will be happening, is what need to be remembered. So, let's go to the next question. Acute pancreatitis is basically graded by all. Nowadays, Glasgow scale is not there only in coma, also in pancreatitis is what need to be remembered. So, let us look at the different types of scaling for pancreatitis. All of you know what are Rancis criteria? Age, WBC count, glucose, LDH, SGOT. No MLS is there. MLS is not the part. It is only diagnostic but not part of the Rancis criteria. And first 48 hours is different from present at admission. That also need to be carefully remembered. What the examiner is asking you. After 48 hours, during the 48 hours, what is important is the hematocrit fall, BUN increase, serum calcium less than 8 and oxygen saturation, base deficit and fluid sequestration. They are important at first 48 hours, whereas LDH and other things are important at admission. Because they are the finer things which commonly are asked in the entrance. Now, what is Glasgow? Just like Rancis, it also has age, WBC is there. But in the case of the Rancis, first 48 hours we said BUN, no? Here urea is also taken. And glucose is one thing that is there in both of them. And PO2 is something which is also... But in the case of the Rancis, what you have is a saturation, which is identified by doing what? Pulse oximetry. But partial pressure of oxygen is important in the case of the Glasgow's prognostic scale. That is a small difference. Calcium is important for both, and LDH is also important. AST, ALT levels are also important. So this is basically the Glasgow's prognostic scale. And one more thing called Apache score is also there. Apache score is basically acute physiological abnormality score. So a score of 9 or more is called as a severe pancreatitis. Similarly, any score of less than 3, greater than 3 in the Glasgow or in the Rancis is also considered to be a severe score. But C-reactive protein, what score of C-reactive protein value is important? A single C-reactive protein is sufficient to prognosticate any value greater than 120 milligrams at the end of the first week means a severe attack. So in the question, C-reactive protein is given as less than 100. So that is the reason it is not going to talk about a severe acute pancreatitis is what need to be known. Only one thing that is left over is the CT severity score. What is the meaning of it? A patient with abdominal pain, background of alcoholism, has come with acute pancreatitis, you have taken the CT abdomen. What is the purpose you are doing? You want to identify peripancreatically, is there any fluid? Is there any necrosis? If it is there, is it involving 1/3, 2/3 or whole of the pancreas? Accordingly, you can grade the severity based on the CT scoring. So accordingly, normal pancreas, pancreatic enlargement, peripancreatic inflammation, single fluid collection, multiple fluid collections will grade according to the CT severity index, otherwise called the Balthasar's score, is what need to be remembered. And also pancreatic necrosis, degree of it also will indicate, doctor. So generally, a CT scoring of 4 to 6 means mortality of 6%, 7 to 10 means it is 17. So in our given case, CT score greater than 6 definitely indicates a severe pancreatitis is what need to be remembered. So finally, Glasgow scale, number 1, Apache score greater than 9, CT score greater than 6, 3, 6, 9 you can remember in relation to the acute pancreatitis. Let's go to the next question. Cholecystectomy, nowadays we are doing directly through the laparoscopic cholecystectomy, right? So by doing a open technique of the laparoscopic port insertion, can it decrease the incidence of the post-laparoscopic cholecystectomy bile duct injuries is the question. The question is whether you use an open technique or a closed technique, doctor. It has nothing to do with the post-laparoscopic cholecystectomy is what is clearly being identified in large number of studies. That is the reason that is not going to show any amount of advantage. But definitely, following the open cholecystectomy, what is the incidence of the bile duct injuries? It is about 0.2 to 0.3%. See, a patient in whom you have done a laparoscopic cholecystectomy in the post-laparoscopic phase will come with jaundice. Then at that point of time, the surgeon who has done the cholecystectomy will be questioned. While the process you are removing the gallbladder, did you injure my bile ducts? That is called basically post-cholecystectomy bile duct injuries. Generally, it will be very, very less if you are a very good surgeon. And incidence rates following the laparoscopic cholecystectomy will be 3 times higher than that of an open cholecystectomy is what need to be remembered. Because laparoscopy is like basically fighting in a closed room with a team, peeping through the keyhole. So that is the reason there is a greater chances of causing the injury compared to that of the open cholecystectomy. But the kind of technique that you use is not going to affect, the very procedure is going to affect. Open cholecystectomy has got a less chances of causing the bile duct injury than the laparoscopic cholecystectomy is the golden rule that should not be forgotten. Let's go to the next question. There are so many manifestations of ulcerative colitis. Definitely one question is going to come on the inflammatory bowel disease. If you don't revise and go to entrance, even if you revise, it is difficult to answer because you don't come across answer for this kind of questions in regular textbooks, right? So here you use your common sense, doctor. Negative marking is there, don't use common sense. Not to answer it is the biggest common sense that can prevail at that point. So what is the one which is not treatable with colectomy? If you have done the colectomy and kept a colostomy, on the colostomy edge this pyoderma can develop. So that is the reason colectomy is not going to prevent this complication or treat it. Whereas the remaining things, episcleritis, peripheral arthralgia, primary sclerosing cholangitis, which can be extra-intestinal manifestations of the ulcerative colitis, they will regress after you have done the colectomy is the rule that should not be forgotten. So this is a typical appearance of the pyoderma gangrenosum, which is basically a very progressive, painful ulceration. So this is not uncommon, doctor. In your clinical practice, you come across a good number of patients who will say, doctor, anything I do, the ulcer is not healing. They also have some GIT manifestations. You have done the stool examination, you found dysentery. Then the whole picture of whether it is ulcerative colitis, the story will begin. So pyoderma gangrenosum presents with a progressive painful ulceration case of the inflammatory bowel disease. Systemic steroid therapy is the time-tested treatment of choice. Of course, decreasing the amount of the inflammation of intestine is definitely going to decrease the amount of the so-called pyoderma lesions is what I want to underscore. Even after doing colectomy, the patient with the inflammatory bowel disease has a chance of showing the pyoderma gangrenosum into the future is what I want to underscore. Let's talk the next question. Solitary hypoechoic lesion without septa or debris, where do you come across? Very interesting question. So this is an example of a solitary cyst, doctor. It is like a miss, it is not still misses, solitary only. It has no septa at all is what I want to underscore. Now I want to give you a challenge. This has got a lot of septa. Then can you guess what could be this possibility? I am also giving you the gross section of this specimen of the liver. You can make some guess. Yes? Good, good. Hydrated cyst is the one which typically will have this kind of appearance is what need to be remembered. Okay, there are some fluid levels that are seen in this. So this is an example of an amoebic liver abscess with the presence of the septa. So that's the reason liver abscess can cause. Now you should tell me, what is the only one thing that is left over which can lead to multiple cysts in the liver? So Kerlis disease is what it remembered. Basically, it is a congenital hepatic fibrosis with a cyst formation with the cystic dilatation is lined with the cuboidal epithelium is what you see in the case of Kerlis disease is what it remembered. Even it is also multiseptate. Now let's go to the next question. Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, is it gastrin producing D cells or is it the beta cells of the pancreas? It is the gastrin producing cells in the pancreas which will produce excess gastrin. Excess gastrin will go to the parietal cells and make them to produce too much HCl. All that HCl will flow into the duodenum and lead to multiple refractory duodenal ulcers is what need to be remembered. So that is the reason you need to be doubly sure that the Zollinger-Ellison is basically not beta cell. So this is an appearance on laparotomy in the head of the pancreas where you can see the presence of even the lymph nodes which are metastasized because of this Zollinger-Ellison. And somatostatin receptor scintigraphy is one of the modern ways by which the neuroendocrine tumors of the GIT, their metastasis are identified, doctor. Favorite question of the examiner. This is how in the liver the neuroendocrine tumor metastasis can be identified. You can see the presence of this classical lesion. Next question is, posterior urethra is best visualized by which technique? Voiding cystourethrogram. Once for all, you need to basically know. So this is a classical example where cystourethrogram is basically done. You can see the presence of the dilated posterior urethra with the presence of those posterior urethral valves which are abnormal. Because of that, there is a reflex of what you call the dye, and the reflex can go until the level of the kidney. So commonly bedwetting, recurrent urinary tract infections in the children, you need to basically evaluate for the possibility of any posterior urethral valves. Is it seen only in the males, predominantly in the males? That's another favorite question of the examiner. Okay, so let's go to the next question. Intravesical therapy is given with which important agent, doctor? Typically, it is the cystoscopy through which this tumor, bladder tumors, are instilled with a chemotherapeutic agent is what need to be basically remembered. So bladder tumor basically on a standard cystoscopy will be having this kind of exophytic appearance. And bladder carcinoma is just like the breast carcinoma, is staged based upon the TNM classification is what need to be basically remembered. And transurethral resection is the primary mode of therapy in the case of the bladder tumor. Until it is not invading the underlying overlying detrusor muscle is the golden rule that should not be forgotten. In addition to the resection, the BCG installation and the chemotherapy are also considered to be the other modalities of management. So BCG becomes the answer is what need to be remembered. Let's go to the next question. Which is the narrowest part of the ureter? So please remember, ureter has got four important places where it becomes narrowed. Number one is at the pelvic-ureteric junction while it is coming out of the renal pelvis. Number two is at the level of the bifurcation of the common iliac artery. It is the area where that iliac artery will be overriding it. So at this place, if you are trying to do any gynecological surgery, there is a chance that you can injure the ureter is what need to be remembered. And also at the point of the entry into the bladder also is another important place where there can be a ureteric constriction. Of all, the most important place is where ureter is entering into the bladder is the area where it is most constricted and narrow. Let's go to the next question. Renal cell carcinoma, which is the most common type, doctor? Clear cell around the nucleus, cytoplasm is clear, is what you see is the most common variant of this Gravitt's tumor, otherwise called the renal cell carcinoma, is what I want to underscore. Let's go to the next question. Which tumor alpha-fetoprotein is elevated? Hepatocellular carcinoma. Is it elevated in the case of the other variant, fibrolamellar variant? It is not elevated, is what need to be remembered. And diagnosis of congenital megacolon, how do you want to do? Transmural rectal biopsy, not simple rectal biopsy, is very, very important, doctor. Now, if you give the barium enema, the contrast material will be outlining that bubble segment which is not having the ganglion. And above this, you can see the post-enotic dilatation which is visible. So the dilated part is the one which is having the normal bubble. And the constricted part is the one which is not having the ganglia is what need to be remembered. Now, if you do the rectal biopsy, typically, you can see ganglia are there. Basically, we look for this. If they are not there, then it is the Hirschsprung's disease where there are no ganglia if you have done the biopsy. And what you can see is only the thickening of the nerves, but there are no ganglia is what need to be remembered. Let's go to the next question. Germ cell tumor of the ovary. Ovary can also have surface epithelial tumors and germ cell tumors. It is a broad classification. Basically, CA125 is produced by the surface epithelial cells is what need to be basically remembered. Hence, it is not the marker in the case of the germ cell tumors is what I want to underscore to all of you. And what is the importance, doctor? Most of the ovarian tumors which are arising from the surface are the ones which produce the CA125. Let's go to the next question. Gastric lymphoma, what do you want to do? Just like the gastric carcinoma, you want to resect every case of the gastric lymphoma. What are the indications for the resection is what the examiner is asking you. So let us talk about the indications. Basically, the aim of the surgery to excise all the tumor with the negative margins. But if you are planning to post a patient with gastric lymphoma for surgery, you need to balance between the morbidity you will be creating by removing the wonderful stomach pouch versus that of taking care of him. That's the reason generally subtotal gastrectomy is preferred over the total gastrectomy in the case of the lymphoma. Hence, bleeding, perforation, residual disease after chemotherapy are all the indications. Simply pain, intractable pain is not considered to be a very important indication is what need to be basically remembered. Let's go to the next question. Programmed cell death is called apoptosis. Then what is the definitive therapy diagnosis for the pulmonary embolism? When do you suspect pulmonary embolism, doctor? Background of DVT is there. Suddenly the woman has come with a shortness of the breath and ECG is showing S1, Q3, T3 pattern and Typically, ABG is showing a type 1 respiratory failure with hypoxemia. Then a loud P2 is heard with the peristinal heave, which is palpable with the acute carpulmonary with the right ventricular failure. You are sure to suspect the possibility of a pulmonary embolus. At that time, do you want to do ventilation perfusion scan? Is the question. Ventilation perfusion scan is a good screening test. But before that, check the radiograph. If the radiograph already is showing some opacities, your ventilation perfusion scan cannot be able to pick up and it shows more false positives. So ventilation perfusion scan is the first investigation of choice only when the chest radiograph is clear. Then you can send, because you can use a chest radiograph as a ventilation scan, and perfusion scan is basically detected and mismatch is basically calculated. Earlier only he had a pulmonary tuberculosis with a lot of fibrosis of the lung and x-ray showing a lot of opacities. Your ventilation perfusion mismatch you can't evaluate. But definite investigation means now the current trend is CT angiography, which is non-invasive angiography. CT scan is done and based on that reconstruction mapping of all the vessels is done. Any filling defect is basically identified and identified as pulmonary embolism. Start the streptokinase thrombolytic therapy for the pulmonary embolism is going to be your next step. But before that you need to start heparin also, because heparin is the first thing that you can do. So there's a reason, doctor, ECG S1, Q3, T3 can help you. But the question is, it is not the one which will enable you to diagnose. Because PIO-PET study is one of the eminent international study done on which investigation is best for screening. Nearly about 30% of people can have normal ECG. The S1, Q3, T3 may not appear. So that is the reason it can't be used. Venography you can't do. Ventilation perfusion scintigraphy, can you do that? But most definitive would be the pulmonary arteriography, which can delineate all those filling defects, is what I want to underscore. Let's go to the next question. Fat embolism, you will see after a major trauma, urinary fat globules will be there, which is the investigation of choice. Then what is meant by the subclavian steel syndrome? How will be the clinical presentation of the patient? Doctor, I am raising my hand and suddenly I am feeling paresthesias are developing and suddenly TIA-like attack is there. Then you need to think of subclavian steel syndrome. Then what is happening here there? Generally, you are having the subclavian vessel, vertebral vessel, vertebral artery. These two things, generally you expect from subclavian blood to flow into the vertebral artery. Then vertebral arteries will be combining to form basilar artery. Basilar artery will be forming posterior cerebral artery, which will be communicating with the posterior communicating artery with the internal carotid. Internal carotid will be giving rise to middle cerebral arteries and anterior cerebral arteries. Anterior cerebral arteries are bound by anterior communicating artery. That's how the Berry's, circle of Willis is formed. Good. Now, in a patient who has got a subclavian steel syndrome, there is typically a retrograde blood flow in the vertebral artery. Because the ipsilateral subclavian artery stenosis is there, that's the reason whenever you are trying to exercise with that ipsilateral arm, then in that setting typically the vertebral artery blood flow, instead of flowing in a anterograde manner, it will be having a reverse flow. Reverse flow of the blood flow into the ipsilateral vertebral artery will be there. So that leads to the development of the neurological symptoms appearing. So that is the reason in the case of the subclavian steel syndrome, the blood of the vertebral artery is stolen by the subclavian is what need to be basically remembered. Let's go to the next question. In breast cancer, chest involvement means what? Involvement of serratus anterior, intercostals, ribs, but not pectoralis major is what need to be remembered. How do you manage a solitary thyroid nodule? There's a lot of story for this. Cold nodule, hot nodule, what you need to do, because the short of time we shall try to abort this. FNAC undoubtedly is the investigation of choice, doctor. And patient should undergo a hemithyroidectomy if that FNAC happened to be very inconclusive. Generally FNACs are very inconclusive. You found in the case of a solitary thyroid nodule presence of follicular cells. Can you say it is a follicular adenoma or carcinoma? You can't say, because FNAC only shows cells, not the underlying tissue invasion or capsular invasion. You need to do the biopsy. So there is a reason hemithyroidectomy need to be done if FNAC report is inconclusive. And why you want to do indirect laryngoscopy, doctor, preoperatively? Otherwise postoperatively patient will go and sue you. Because of your surgery I lost my recurrent laryngeal. You need to do the laryngoscopy preoperatively and prove him that, boss, already your vocal cord is gone, I am not doing anything, I am trying to sincerely remove your thyroid only, is what you need to basically say. That's the reason all these things are true statements. Cold nodule is not always diagnostic of malignancy. There is certain percentage between cold and hot nodules. Okay, let's go to the next question. A 16-year-old boy represents with acute onset of the pain in left testis. Acute left testis pain in a 16-year-old young individual means what, doctor? Testicular torsion, right? So there is a reason color flow Doppler need to know whether blood supply is all right. Scrotal exploration is need to be done immediately without delay. And if left testis is not viable on exploration, then orchidectomy need to be done judgmentally is what need to be basically known. And don't give antibiotics to that fellow who will be finally landing with a, what type of infarction, doctor? Venous or arterial infarct? Pale or a dark infarct in the testis? Yes? Venous, is it having dual blood supply or unilateral blood supply?